And with Göran and Pedro Delgado from the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, and it's a privilege to have you with us here. It really is. And with Göran, we just transitioned from what was to what is. And I think with Göran, we're going to start thinking about what will be. What will be. And how we need to be active agents into shaping that future. One of the things that I learned with Göran a number of years ago when I first visited him was that it's not about thinking our way into acting, but rather about acting our way into thinking differently or better or futuristically and so on. Göran has titled this using the word game. He was a basketball coach. We spend time when we connect talking initially about sports for about 10 minutes and then about whatever else we need to talk about, and it's always a joy. Göran chaired the Strategic Advisory Board this year, and the flavor and the spirit that you've sensed in this conference is related to the effort of your feedback, for sure. That's the primary driver, but also the gentle chairmanship of Göran. So I'd like you to join me in showing our appreciation for Göran Henriks from Jönköping County in Sweden.
Good luck. Okay, let's see here now. I hoped I should get some music, but I'm not sure if it will work. Could you technicians up there help me? A little higher.
They say I'm caught up in a dream. Well, life will pass me by if I don't open up my eyes. So that's fine by me. So wake me up when it's all over. When I'm wiser and I'm older. All this time I was finding myself and I didn't know.
Okay, thank you. That's enough. Do you know who has produced this song? Avicii. It's a Swedish disc jockey. And do you know, I think he is a signal of a change of the game of the music industry. All good songers love to have him playing their music with different covers, where people come together just as we do here, and they love to have him share their music with others. Historically, it was the singer who owned the event. Nowadays, everybody owns the event because there is someone who can show the world how good the singers are. And I think that this strategic advisory board that I work with and the people I have worked with over the years, they are a gift for me because they have learned me so much. But it took me some years to really realize that it's not about doing projects. It's really about understanding that what you achieve in your life has been thanks to the people around you. And this is my three children, Sofia, Christopher, and Tobias, when we visit Japan. And some of the things I'm going to talk with you about today are inspired of different kind of mindfulness. These are the topics I promised to talk about, but I think that this picture, do you dare to take a step outside your daily work, symbolize more what I promise to do. You know, actually, this is where I am. Botticelli painted a painting somewhere around 1400, and it was Venus leaving the shell. Outside my house in Jönköping, a young artist made a sculpture that symbolizes what it takes to go out of the shell. And it takes learning and innovation and an inner need to change the game before the game changes you. How can I say this? Haven't you changed the game enough, people tell me. Well, of course, we have many wins. In my county, the residents are highly satisfied. We have the best hospitals in Sweden. We won hygiene prize. We have top results in patient safety in rare events. One of the hospitals, they have had one rare event in 900 days in care-related infection. And we recently won an award among 220 projects of social innovation for aging in Europe. So, of course, we have a lot of wins. But, you know, wins are just a daily thing. It is a question of how to sustain successful over time. And then I don't believe that even if all these methods and models we are using, like patient involvement, safety, we are using lean and patient-centered processes, discipline, and organic learning processes. They are not enough. We can learn more from others. Aledi Skar-Brandrud and Per Hjortdal wrote recently an article where they said that the success factors in continuous quality improvement are listening to the voice of the patient and the processes involving the patient and the family. Everyone has two jobs. That is our framework and platform that you need always. But now our challenge is to move from an idea where volume is the key challenge. How many things can we do per day to deliver a care that talks about value and value for the individuals, each of them? This is, for me, change the game before the game changes you. How can we make the transition to a situation where prevention are our main approach, where we don't talk about under or overuse? We know that we are doing right from the beginning. All processes are multi-professional or cross-professional, and we learn quicker than we do today. I have, just as Pedro said, over the years, a special joy to sports. And you can see here Barcelona team and also a Swedish handball team. Now, the coach from Barcelona moved to Bayern Munich, and suddenly, not Barcelona is the top team any longer. It is Bayern Munich that are the top team. You could always say that that depends on each individual player, but that is too easy description. But the interesting thing is that these two teams are the significant best teams compared to everybody else. They must have a different kind of game plan. As I understand it, when they play football or soccer, they move their 10 players as a system over the court and minimize the length between the striker and the defender. So all 10 are strikers and all 10 are defenders all the time. What they also have done, besides thinking as a system, they have built in redundancy and resilience. So when a player gets the ball, he always has four options to pass a player that is in a better position. Because as soon as a player gets the ball, there are four players that try to get the ball, because the other team attack the ball holder. So that means that there are five players involved in every movement of the ball. How can we learn from that in healthcare? The other team is a handball team where they have understood that it's not the coach that talks in the timeouts. It is the players that talks and do the strategic decisions about how to shorten or minimize the risk and shorten the distance between the players. How can we develop a work environment where it's the players who talks and not the coach? I think it comes through ideas of being agile, adapting, exploring, facilitating, and even love paradoxes. This is why we have to communicate. We have to speed to value. We have to come together, take out all waste. And that has to be done by the players, not the coach. And we have to maybe do less, shorten the way we are running, so we can keep our engagement and inspiration. My leadership experience says me that if you want to change something quickly, you need Martemeo. Martemeo is an idea that comes from family practice, where you film the child and the mother and the father. And instead of looking on the poor relationships, the coach of that meeting takes out the best pictures of the relationship between the mother and father and the child. And when the family comes back, they talk about how can we do these situations more often. This combined with the Japanese and Chinese word kanji, that means that you can have two capacities at the same time, both adaptation and adoption, is for me the future. Why? Well, you know, changing and adapting are not the same, and the differences comes because there is no goal inherent in change, as the quip says, stuff happens. Adaptation, on the other hand, is directed towards a goal, suitability. Change is often mindless, but adaptation is mindful, and adaptation can be considered as mindful response to change. So from my point of view, we should talk much more about what does it mean to adapt and adopt, and less about change. Change is happening all the time. Our role is to identify what is important to do, and for success tomorrow, we need a new mindset to embrace change by being focused, fast, and flexible. Go from volume to value. And it's one thing to say be adaptive, but we need to go further, learn from concrete practices or mod quicker, and respecting the social learning processes. And I really feel that this is why we come together at these conferences, because we have understood that. But how can we move that into our daily work? Well, then we need leaders that focus on adaptation, exploring, facilitating, and riding paradoxes. And we need to use those things in a new world, where many people are engaged instead of in a room, in an absent-minded community, and they are always updated. What did Fiona say this morning? We had over 15 million tweets or connections with our tweets. We reached more than 15 million people. This is the new world. This is the Poe. You know, the Poe started Twitter the second day he became a Poe. And more and more in my home country, I noticed that patient groups, they leave the idea that they should meet our system. They want to be a part of an absent-minded community where they can decide when the contact should be taken. That brings us to a completely new science. This is a company, Gavagi, that decided that they should do linguistics as new mathematics to new quality registers. And they are working on that now. You know, they realized when the Arab Spring should come, 2 months ahead it came. Because they did linguistic analysis on the Twitter with strong search motors. Can you imagine how we can change our quality register work? We do linguistic analytics on our patient records, of course. It's completely different from how we think today. Now, John Kotter says, you can't yet disown the hierarchical system that runs your business. But if you don't, it could kill your company. The very strengths of the hierarchical system become fatal flaws when swift change is required. Kotter says it slows down communication and the flow of information. The policies, the rules, and the procedures that govern its workings become barriers to change. Its main focus, the maintenance of business as usual, takes precedence over the new business, and the silos and the habitual behavior it spawns inhibit the new strategic initiatives and innovations. John Kotter, one of the most well-known management professors, says that we have to have two structures in one system. We need one structure for accountability, and we need one structure for learning and innovation. I agree, but what is it then that should become the glue in between these two systems? It's how we communicate, it is how we collaborate, but it's also how we coordinate and connect. And I'm going to give you some examples about the new world and why connecting and attachment and coupling is so important. What you just saw was a stroke patient, a patient that just have had a stroke, that were sitting on a simulation bicycle, trying to learn how to bicycle again. This is just the start of a completely new approach to prevention. We will see so many new ways to help people that have chronic diseases. That will change the way we work with our diagnostic work and our treatment work. And what I can see now is that prevention and wellness becomes the third and the fourth area of focus. My colleagues in Jönköping County, they are experts in diagnostic world and treatment world. They are not experts in prevention and wellness. And I think that the patients and the individuals with experience can help us a lot with that. But how do we take those steps to make them our coaches? Well, first we need space for that. And many of our systems are put into very hard budget work, and money is always the constraint. Last year, in Yama, we could read 14 different articles about less is more. And in these articles, we can see that if we change the work processes around asthma, around hyperactivity and disorder, about breast cancer, about chronic kidney disease, about high blood pressure, about high cholesterol, about lung cancer, and use this knowledge to change our work processes, there is a large space of resource for this new world. But it takes a new mindset. The triple aim is a new mindset, where you always take into account the patient experience, the results you are doing, and the cost of the processes. Here is another example. This is a calculation motor developed through a network in Europe and Uppsala University that calculate your weight, your smoking, your lack of physical fitness, and alcohol consumption. And you can, in this calculator, change the different variables, and you can go into the calculator and see how much can we win in the diabetes work, in the stroke work, in the colon cancer work, if we achieve a new level of health in the population for that group. So we have the resources. It's a question how we find them. I think the only way to find them is not asking the top management to give us stronger quality incentives or ask them to buy innovations or develop new public management. I am sure that we find these resources if we focus on living and life and the word that I come back to later that I called exnovation. Why? Well, the old mindset was that we were everything as a system and the individual were small. But we are now facing, and in that world, we were accounting everything in pieces, and everybody who were in contact with each piece tried to optimize that piece. The new mindset is that the system is small and the individuals possibility to be empowered and in charge of its own process gives the new resources. You still promote the process, but it is how we promote the individual. This is an example from how we win resources in the county of Jönköping. We work with something that is called enhanced recovery after surgery. And in this data platform, we can put in 24 different indicators and see how well we are following them. And here you see how 7 hospitals in our region, their compliance rate to 24 different procedures. And here you can see the complication rate that the patients that they work with get. And here you can see the reoperations, the mortality, and the anastomotic leaks. Starting working with this, we have reduced the length of stay at the hospital from 10 days to 5 days. And this is the compliance to the different 24 indicators. Each day at the hospital is about $1,000, or in Swedish krona, 8,000 krona. It's more, it's $1,200 actually. And we start to do these simple calculations and see that the care-related infection makes another 4 days, and 2011, 6.9% of our patients got care-related infections, and this year it's 3.8%, and we gain a lot of resources, of course. We map our patients' process through the system. Here it says prevention, needs, first contact, investigation, decision of treatment, and so on. And when you click on these different squares, the different things that should be done come up. So the patient can at home see what should happen when they come. The old mindset we still have. We are measuring number of overbedding per 100 available beds in somatic care. But that focus on something we don't want to have. Why not focus instead of something that we want to have? This is the compliance of following the guidelines connected to care-related infection and our position among the 21 counties or healthcare system in Sweden is here, and this is central, it's one type of catheters, and here is another type of catheters, and you can see that it's just a few counties that can be compared with us. When we worked with this, we saw that the change have given us more than 10 million kronor. Our challenge as leaders is, of course, to see where this money are and then use them for innovation and new design. This is our work in prevention. And you can see here, this is amount of ulcers, and this is amount of action taken on risk analysis. And these are the different healthcare systems in Sweden. And you can then read from this figure that the systems that have the least amount of ulcers are also doing the actions. And the counties that have the most amount of ulcers are not taking actions on the risk analysis in ulcers. This is about the same work. This is a comparison of weight reduction and actions performed. And here you can see counties that have done the actions and how many percent of their patients that have problems with weight loss. And here excuse me, this is not counties, it's municipalities. And here you see municipalities that are not doing the actions and have a large amount of elderly losing weight. How can we get the adaptation of this to work? To make people realize that this is the way we have to change the game if we want to meet the future. Annemai said to us, I know why you can't adapt to a new situation. She said, 2008 to us, you don't meet me with respect. You don't look into my eyes and you don't talk with me. You talk to me. She wrote the book. That was our flip point. We understood we need a change. That was the old world when we talked a lot about how we meet the patient. Britt-Marie, Christian and Patrick learned us you shouldn't talk about what is not working. You should instead show how it can be done. This is the team that started self-analyze work, where the patient are doing the dialysis himself, self-dialysis. And this is Patrick, who is now employed by the county. The story behind this work is that Christian and Britt-Marie found each other. Christian was the patient, Britt-Marie was the nurse. And Britt-Marie and Christian started to talk about how can I, as a nurse, become a coach and change the world for you so you can do your dialysis when you like and not when I decide. Today, all our hospitals in the county have self-dialysis. We have no care-related infections on the entities, and our resources can be 20% less at least, maybe 30% in this process. By having the patients doing it themselves. But it started with Martemeo and Kanji. It didn't start with a learning situation where Britt-Marie taught. How important is this? Well, I would like to take it a little further. I see around me in Sweden a new epidemic. It can be called syndemic epidemic. That is a set of linked health problems involving two or more afflictions interacting and contributing to excess burden of disease in a population. Syndemics occur when health-related problems cluster by person, place, or time. To prevent the syndemic, one must prevent or control not only each affliction, but also the forces that tie those afflictions together. The term syndemic was first used in 1992 and strips away the idea that illness from extraordinary or supernatural forces and places the responsibility for affliction squarely within the public arena. It acknowledged the relationship and signals a commitment to understanding population health as fragile, dynamic state requiring continual effort to maintain and one that is imperiled when social and physical forces operate in harmful ways. When social and physical forces operate in harmful ways. So what is happening in some areas in Sweden is that when children come to life, they live in circumstances that they very early come to chronic diseases. And that is a syndemic problem. And that problem cannot be solved without attachment and helping people to a better life. If we continue to just do inputs to the symptoms we see, this will grow, at least in our country. And we will get more and more chronic diseases where we see a psychosocial connection. So this is the real transformation. To change our approach so we can meet tomorrow's health problems. We have a fantastic person in our, or many fantastic persons, but one fantastic person is Annette Nilsson and her pensioners Elsa and Lars. They have, since 2006-07, been engaged in an idea that is called Passion for Life. It is a social innovation in aging that is not owned by anyone. Today, over 30,000 pensioners just in Sweden, but also in Finland, Norway, Singapore, England, Canada, United States, comes together in study circles, we call it, where they talk about their wellness. And the wellness is about how they eat, how they do physical training, what kind of social relationships they have, and safety at home. Can we start that for all young people too? How can we make passion for life to something that everybody can be involved in? I think Don Berwick yesterday had a fantastic perspective of this work. But it takes a different kind of management. A Martemeo, where we search for the strengths and help people to learn quicker. Now, the elderly in Passion for Life, they have happiness all the time because they are now app developer. So they start to communicate through different kind of ideas and produce apps to show each other. This is a movement without any borders. It goes everywhere. So Kotter says, you have to move outside the traditional hierarchies and optimize instead the now because the complexity is so big. This is flip makers in my world. It is Google. It is Britt-Marie who made it possible for Christian to be the star of self-dialysis. It is Annette and Elsa and Lars who said, healthcare is all about passion for life. It is a tango between two people where one has experiences of problems and the other one support. Now, Barcelona and our Swedish national team in handball. What do they have together? Well, they have that knowledge that the pass that, or dip, I would say, a pass that goes wrong, or when the opponent steals the ball, that is dangerous. So they try to build in an idea of quality first. My orthopedic says that a reoperation takes time of 3 operations in prosthetic surgery. Oh, it is my surgeons in the surgical department. That means that at the operation theater, a reoperation takes 3 times longer. So how can we do it right from the first time? We have to admit that life is something in between the normal and the risk, sometimes illegal, says Sam Alberti. But I think that we have to move to look at safety as our most innovative approach. It starts with exnovation. An exnovation is to do the 5S all the time, to standardize and be clear of what is important to have in place in forehand. But it is also about how can the players be empowered so they can do it themselves and not through instructions or from the top. To come to that level of performance in healthcare, I believe that we have to move away from a model of input control to a model of individual control. That means that the responsibility and control has to be implemented to the health situation. The dominating mediation is compound service concept and mobile inputs. The primary value is quality for the individual in combination with efficiency in the health system. The incentive is effective collaboration. The quality is about degree of the ongoing matching between needs and skills. It's leaving lean in the inputs and find the ideas in the individual process instead. This takes both individual learning and social learning, but it also takes standardization and improvements at the same time, doing things right and doing the right things, lean and social movement, reduce variation, map and compass and decision making and sense making. Everything at the same time. But most of all, I think it requires what David White said. I do not think you can really deal with change without the person asking real questions about who they are and how they belong in the world. So, please, technicians, help me with some new music. It's time to wake up. It's time to leave the quality conference with strength and believing in yourself and following your pledge. Thank you very much.